Rurouni Kenshin is one of the greatest shonen manga of all time, and its impact on the landscape of modern shonen can't be overstated. But the most recent news of its creator, Nobuhiro Watsuki, has left a bad taste in people's mouths. For those who don't know, Watsuki was charged with possession of child pornography late last year, right after a sequel series to the original Kenshin manga had just started. After the incident, the manga had been put on hiatus. As of February, Watsuki had been fined almost $2,000 and is now getting ready to resume his manga in early June. You can see why this has left people like me between a rock and a hard place. I love Rurouni Kenshin. It's on my shortlist for the greatest manga of all time and is probably my third favorite anime franchise ever. I even have a replica Sakabato that I bought because I'm an adult and I think cartoon sword boys are cool. All this is to say that it's hard for me to defend the continued reading of the sequel manga because of Watsuki's actions. I think it's a more nuanced issue than people are making it seem, but in fear of getting too political, I don't want to give my personal stance, as that's not what this video is about. What I want to do is address the concerns that the legacy of the original series might be tarnished in some way. Now, I can't speak for the spirit of the sequel or if it might somehow affect the original down the line, but I can say that the original is as close to a masterpiece as any other shonen manga. Hunter x Hunter, Yu Yu Hakusho, Berserk, irrefutable classics that most people consider to be some of the best in the genre, and Rurouni Kenshin has outsold all of them in manga sales. From its lovable characters to its socio-political undertones to its simple yet memorable character designs, everything came together so perfectly, and it's all exemplified by the protagonist, Himura Kenshin. Kenshin is one of the oldest main characters in any shonen series. At the age of 28, he's seen enough violence and politics to understand that he doesn't want to be a part of any of it. He's killed enough people in trying to forge a new era that he's now living a life of atonement. He lives by a no-killing rule and wields the Sakabato, a sword that has a reverse blade so jackasses like me that bought one don't kill someone while they're trying to be a kick-ass samurai. Kenshin is set in his ways from the very beginning of the series and is often pushed to his limits on if he'll kill again, and it's his realistic point of view that makes you question if he'll ever do it. In the first episode, Kenshin meets Karu, his future wife, who teaches a style of swordsmanship that doesn't kill people. When a former student tries to use that style for murder, Karu claims that the sword should be used to protect people. Kenshin immediately dismisses that idea and laments that the sword can only be used for killing, but he prefers the sweet ideals that Karu follows. This small exchange gives us a deeper understanding of Kenshin's mindset, as he disagrees with Karu, but has already decided to follow her way of life before the series even started. If Kenshin had been a younger protagonist, then we probably would have gotten an arc dedicated to him learning and accepting this idea, but Kenshin is learned from his growing up as a manslayer. Speaking of, Rurouni Kenshin has the context of its story changed by watching his manslayer days in the OVAs. All the OVAs are simply outstanding. Not that one. Trust and Betrayal, the most well-known of the OVAs, follows Kenshin as a young man coming to terms with his position in the world and ultimately deciding to continue to fight for what he believes in, only to make atonement after the fighting is over. It's also the only one where he kills a metric fuck ton of people. I mean, look at this shit! Holy fuck, he just stabbed that dude. Jesus Christ, who is cleaning up after this guy? The hyper-violent, kind of gory aesthetic drew a lot of people in, but it's Kenshin's romance that kept them interested. Tomoe was Kenshin's first love, and her death at his hands was the biggest influence on him in the main series. And her death comes back to haunt him several times, which brings us to the other OVA, Reflections. Reflections follows Karu, well, reflecting on her past with Kenshin as she waits for him to come home. Kenshin left to help end a war going on and had left Karu and their son Kenji all alone, but is now trying to come back as he's dying from an unknown disease.
What is it, like ninja AIDS? Yeah, I don't fucking know.
By the end of it all, Kenshin returns home and dies in Karu's arms. Now, people have some problems with this OVA. It tries to fit an entire arc of the manga into 30 minutes and horribly butchers it. Kenshin's motivations for leaving in the first place are out of character, and nobody really wants to see him die from, like, the shittiest disease ever. All those complaints are valid, but I think the OVA is still important for the fact that Kenshin dies. With the culmination of the OVAs and the original series, Rurouni Kenshin is no longer about a wandering samurai trying to find atonement in a new era. It's about the life and death of a man who fought for his ideals, his learning and growing, his family, and the legacy that he leaves behind. In the manga, Kenshin doesn't die, so it leaves off with a happy ending. Kenshin and Karu are happy together, Kenji seems to be a good kid instead of Kenshin's estranged son. All is well with the world. But when the OVA came out, Watsuki was asked about the ending and Kenshin's death. See, Watsuki didn't write Reflections, but oversaw its development. He claimed that he didn't want the manga to end that way because Kenshin had already been through enough crap, but that if he kept writing, he probably would have ended it in the same way. On a side note, one of the reasons I want to continue reading the sequel is to see if he'll actually follow through on that statement. The Reflection OVA also sees the passing of the torch to Kenshin's son at the very end and implies that he has his own journey ahead of him, now that his father's gone. We're seeing that trope be fully fleshed out now with the Boruto anime. Seeing the main character's son have the same look and skills of their father but go through different hardships under different circumstances. I bet if the Bleach manga ever came back, they'd do the same thing with Ichigo's little shit stain of a son. I don't think this trope was started by Rurouni Kenshin. That'd have to go to Dragon Ball, but they fucked it up by not focusing on Gohan after Goku's death to Cell, therefore making the trope they started a failure. Rurouni Kenshin might have just actually popularized the trope. Fans loved teenage Kenji and wanted to see more of him, so it makes sense that someone would recognize what Kenshin did and capitalize on its formula. Now, they couldn't actually keep Kenji's story going because Watsuki didn't write that OVA, but the narrative setup is there. You know, after saying all this, I just really love Rurouni Kenshin. While this news is heartbreaking, it also gives me an opportunity to talk about the series. I couldn't really find a reason outside of this to make a video about it. I don't know if I'm still going to read Kenshin. Smarter people than me have argued why we shouldn't, but from my own personal stance, I'm torn because I still love the series to death. If you're in the same position as me, I can't tell you what to do. All I can do is reaffirm you that this series is still a legend. And maybe in a time like this, that's all we need. If you liked the video, subscribe and hit the notification icon to stay up to date with all the new stuff I put out. Help me spread the video around by sharing it and go follow me on Twitter. Love and peace, everyone.